son, Harry, but he couldn't. He couldn't kill that little boy. Nobody knows why or how. They're saying that when he couldn't kill Harry Potter, Voldemort's powers somehow broke. And that's why he's gone. Dumbledore nodded grimly. It's true, faltered Professor McGonagall. After all he's done, all the people he's killed, he couldn't kill a little boy? It's just astonishing. Of all the things to stop him. But how, in the name of heaven, did Harry survive? You can only guess, said Dumbledore. You may never know. Professor McGonagall pulled out a lace handkerchief and dabbed at her eyes beneath her spectacles. Dumbledore gave a great sniff as he took a golden watch from his pocket and examined it. It was a very odd watch. It had 12 hands but no numbers and said a little planets were moving around the edges. It must have made sense to Dumbledore, though, because he put it back in his pocket and said, Hagrid Slade, I suppose it was he who told you I'd be here, by the way. Yes, he said, and I don't suppose you're going to tell me why you're here? Of all places, I've come to bring Harry to his aunt and uncle. They're the only family he has left now. You can't mean the people who live here, cried Professor McGonagall, jumping to her feet and pointing at number four. Dumbledore, you can't. I've been watching them all day. You couldn't find two people who are less like us. And they've got this son. I saw him kicking his mother all the way up the street, screaming for sweets. Harry Potter, come and live here. It's the best place for him, said Dumbledore firmly. His aunt and uncle will be able to explain everything to him once he's older. I've written them a letter. A letter, repeated Professor McGonagall, faintly sitting back up, down on the wall. Really, Dumbledore, you think you can explain all this in a letter? These people will never understand him. He'll be a famous legend. He'll be famous. A legend. I wouldn't be surprised today if today was known as Harry Potter Day in the future. There will be books written about Harry. Every child in our world will know his name. Exactly, said Dumbledore, looking very serious over the top of his half-moon glasses. It would be enough to turn any boy's head famous for before he can walk and talk, famous for something he won't even remember. Can you see how much better he'll be growing away from that until he's ready to take it in? Professor McGonagall opened her mouth, changed her mind, swallowed, and then said, Yes, you're right, of course. But how was the boy getting here, Dumbledore? He eyed his cloak suddenly as she thought he might be hiding Harry underneath it. Hagrid's bringing him. You think it wise to trust Hagrid something as important as this? I trust Hagrid with my life, said Dumbledore. I'm not saying his heart isn't in the right place, said Professor McGonagall grudgingly. But you can't pretend he's not careless. He does tend to... What was that? A low rumbling sound had broken the silence around them. It grew steadily louder as they looked up and down the street for some sign of headlight. It swelled into a roar as they both looked up at the sky. And a huge motorcycle fell out of the air and landed on the roof road in front of them. The motorcycle was huge. It was nothing the man seemed astride. It was almost twice as tall as a normal man and at least five times as wide. He looked simply too big to be allowed and so wild. Long tangles of bushy black hair and beard hid most of his face. He had hands inside the trash can lids. His feet in their leather boots were like baby dolphins in vast muscular arms. In his vast muscular arms, he was holding a bundle of blankets. Hagrid said Dumbledore, sounding relieved. At last, where'd you get that motorcycle? Borrowed it, Professor Dumbledore, sir, said the giant, climbing carefully off the motorcycle as he spoke. Young Sirius Black lent it to me. I have got him, sir. No problems were there? No, sir. Our house was almost destroyed, but I got him out right before the muggles started swarming around. He fell asleep as we was flying over Bristol. Dumbledore and Professor McGonagall bent forward over the bundle of blankets inside, just visible as a baby boy fast asleep under a tuft of jet black hair over his forehead. They could see a curious shaped cut like a bolt of lightning. Is that where, whispered Professor McGonagall? Yes, said Dumbledore. He'll have that scar forever. Can't you do something about it, Dumbledore? Even if I could, I wouldn't. Scars can come in handy. I have one myself above my left knee that is a perfect map of London, of the London Underground. Well, give him here, Hagrid. He'd better get this over with. Dumbledore took Inquisitor's house. Could I say goodbye to him, sir? Asked Hagrid. He bent his great shaky head over Harry and gave him what must have been a very scratchy, whispery kiss. Then suddenly, Hagrid let out a howl like a wounded dog. Shh! His Professor McGonagall, you wake the muggles. Sorry, sobbed Hagrid, taking out a large spotted handkerchief and burying his face in it. But I can't stand it. Lily and James are dead, and poor little Harry off to live with the muggles. Yes, yes, it's all very sad, but get a grip on yourself, Hagrid, or we'll be found. Professor McGonagall whispered, patting Hagrid gingerly on the arm. As Dumbledore stepped over the low garden wall and walked to the front door, he laid Harry gently on the doorstep, took a letter out of his cloak, tucked it inside Harry's blankets, and then came back to the other two. For a full minute, the three of them stood and looked at the little bundle. Hagrid's shoulders shook. Professor McGonagall blinked fiercely, and the twinkling light that usually shone from Dumbledore's eyes seemed to go out. Well, said Dumbledore, finally, that's that. We've got no business staying here. We may as well go join the celebrations. Yes, said Hagrid in a muffled voice. I'd best get this bike away. Good night, Professor McGonagall. Professor Dumbledore, sir. Wiping his streaming eyes on his jacket sleeve, Hagrid spun himself onto the motorcycle, kicked the engine to life, and with a roar, it rose into the air and off into the night. I shall see you soon, I expect, Professor McGonagall, said Dumbledore, nodding to her. Professor McGonagall blew her nose in reply. Dumbledore turned and walked back down the street. On the corner, he stopped and took out the silver putter outer. He clicked once, and 12 balls of light sped back into their street lamp, so that private drive glowed suddenly orange, and he could make out a tabby cat sitting in the corner. What? No, I can't. Get out.
Could you do this after you're done with your video?
On the other end of the street, you could just see the bundle of blankets on number four.
I can make it.
Yes, I am. Get out. Good luck, Harry, he murmured. He turned it on his heel, and with a swish of his cloak, he was gone. A breeze ruffled the neat hedges of Private Drive, which laid silently and tiny under the inky sky. The very last place you would expect an astonished thing to happen. Harry Potter rolled over inside his blankets without waking up. One small hand closed on the letter beside him, and he slept on. Not knowing he was special, not knowing he was famous, not knowing he would be woken in a few hours' time by Miss Dursley screaming as she opened the front door to put the milk bottles, nor that he would spend the next few days being prodded and pinched by his cousin Dudley. He couldn't know that at this very moment. People meeting in secret all over the country were holding up their glasses, saying in hushed voices, to Harry Potter, the boy who lived. That's all for chapter 1. The next chapter is A Vanishing